cold start.
Pure perfection. How you doing, guys? We're looking at a Penton 250 Hair Scrambler. Ken's getting on for a little spin. This bike is absolutely mint. No excuses. It's a perfect time capsule. Low mileage, light use. And that's a bike you want to take out and rip on. Because it is one of the highest performance two strokes of its day. Now, the bike definitely shows that it has never been used much. You can tell by the foot pegs, the frame rails under the engine, but it's got all of, it's bristling with the top components of the period. Cherry anti-forks. The rear shocks have been replaced with period correct works performance shocks. But all the OEM stuff's there. And the signature of John Penton on the front. The great man John Penton himself signed this bike. But all the original components are there. The headlight, taillight, speedo, the throttle, the Magura throttle, etc. This is a bike you could have shown up at an Enduro in 1976 and be a pretty good rider and win overall. It's just a massive motorcycle. It had such great potential, and it was no wonder it was the bike of choice for the World Trophy team for the ISDT in 1973. It's got all the hard parts on it. The exhaust, I think a lot of those went south. People didn't use them back in the day because they thought they had higher performance parts that they could add to it. But that stock exhaust tip, you wouldn't see that anywhere. And the lights, the headlight, taillight, everything works. The rims are straight. It's never been used in the rocks, you could tell. And around here in New England, New York, wherever that bike was ridden, it was not used hard in the rocks. And if you look, all the hand controls are there. The switch gear is here. And the choke, kill button, all these parts are OEM parts. The tool bag is there. The leather tool bag is still intact. This bike was dry stored with a radiant heat floor for most of its life. And it's got the Penton factory endorsed GS tuning, which you can see on the gas tank. There's GS tune stickers. That's a big deal. The performance package. Performance package on a already high performance motorcycle. This takes me back to the Enduros from back in the day. You'd see a Penton 250 GS run up the street just like this at a local Enduro here in New England. This bike, looking over the side covers on this bike, they're made of fiberglass. And fiberglass side covers are known for chipping and flaking and breaking. If you stood up on the pegs on that bike and rode it much, those side covers would be worn or gone or broken. But this bike has absolutely perfect side covers on it. Yeah, that's bringing me back for sure. You know, all the boys going by and their KTMs, their Penton KTMs back in the day, making that same exact sound. Cool stuff. You could use that bike for a dual sport, you really could. But if you needed it, it will give you what you want in power. It lifts the front wheel and first, second, third gear. Plenty of power, but absolutely tame when you need it to be tame. Like here on the street or in the tight section in the woods. It'd be a perfect vintage Enduro mount, absolutely. Yeah, in our service department, we, as a matter of course, check compression ratios, compression levels, and this has 200 PSI, which is incredible. 200. That's a fresh motor. If it ever was worn at all in the first place, with that light of use, it's probably stock, original, unmolested, which is the way I like them. The first gear clutch out test is a good measure of how the bike is tuned, how it's performing. Not only full on throttle, but near closed throttle at slow speed, clutch out. That's a good testament to the bike's tuning. It's set up properly.
What do you think, Billy? This thing's freaking awesome. It hauls ass.
Yeah, it hauls ass, and it sounds great. It brought me back to Enduros from the 70s, Ken.
You know, with a 6-speed overdrive transmission, you take it out on the road, it'll cruise all day and without revving too high. And it's got that super low first gear, like a granny gear for crawling up the side of a mountain.
There you go. I think it would make a good dual sport bike. Really would.
Absolutely. And definitely a head turner.
Yeah, for sure. Well, these bikes were made to do 100-mile long, rock hard enduros. And why wouldn't it make a good dual sport bike?
What a remarkable machine. It's got the original seat on it, which is, it shows a little patina, but just remarkable for a 50-year-old bike to be original like that. And I tell you what, the upgraded shocks on the back, the Works Performance shocks, when you hit a bump, normally you'd be bracing yourself, but they take the bumps just like a 2020. I'll bet it feels as good as a new bike on the rear suspension and the front forks. What kind of forks are those? Are those B-doors or what are they?
Those are Cherry Annies, I believe.
Ooh, yeah, they're beautiful.
They're great forks. They might be Baiters. I'm not sure about when they switched over. But
you probably already talked about this, but look at, did you talk about how nice the original chain guide and all the running gear down here is? No evidence, no scratches on the bottom of the frame or dents like you'd see on an off-road bike. The cylinder fins are perfect. The engine cases are beautiful. And even the rims, zoom in on the yellow sticker, the yellow Akron sticker, wrapped in nice set of Michelin cross-country competition tires. 120 90 18 cross competition on the rear, Works Performance shocks, all the chrome is beautiful, all the finishes are beautiful. It truly is a museum piece, signed by John Penton himself 16 years ago. I mean, it just remarkable. Absolutely the best running Penton 250 we've ever had here, in my opinion.
I would say that's probably because it's almost new. This bike is as it was taken out of the crate back in the day. And this is from the era when Penton was switching over to KTM. So they got away from the Sachs motors they had, and they got these super robust KTM engines. And eventually, the Penton mark was lost, and it became full-on KTM. So this is the very beginning of KTM in America, which, as we all know, is leading the pack today and did in these days as well.
I would think if you're a Penton dealer or KTM dealer, having this on the floor, or if you own a museum and you're looking for a world-class piece, this is an investment quality classic. Even the leather original tool pouch is intact with a really cool, unique mounting bracket for it. And look at the front number plate. I don't know if you took a close look at that, but the way it's mounted to the headlight, and it's signed by John Penton. Then the chrome on the headlight, made in Austria. That's original Australian glass. Usually those will get cracked and broken.
It's still got the Made in Austria sticker right on the steering stem there, and the thing just reeks quality. If you look at what the Austrians have done, you know, from the 70s up until the modern two strokes, it has built a legacy of just world-class competition machines.
The fit and finish on it, looking at the engine guard down here, it's not even bent or broken. The springs look to be brand new. The fit and finish on it is the best I've seen on an original KTM Penton from this era. Even the leather Magura covers are intact with just the Magura quick turn throttle. Just a spectacular piece. I don't want to repeat anything Billy may have already said. You already went over the GS tuned model and everything.
I did.
It's definitely faster than the stock one, no doubt about it. It feels like it was professionally ported for a factory race team. What was the production stats on the GS compared to the regular one?
I don't know, but I think they were fairly limited. But that was Penton KTM endorsed GS tuning for bikes back in the day, all the way back into the full-on Penton Sachs, and they had it perfected. They knew how to make the bikes perform for woods or motocross, which are two distinct different tunes. And this bike obviously has the GS tuning for off-road.
The boot from the air box to the air to the carburetor is in mint condition. Usually those are replaced with some aftermarket stuff. Just remarkable. Junior or Billy, is there anything you guys like to add?
Well, the leather tank strap's still in existence, and it displays, you know, the ISDT team. This bike was the bike of choice for the ISDT World Trophy team, I believe. And I may be mistaken on that, but at least in some measure. But this bike is absolutely mint. You know, like I mentioned before, the side covers here, those side covers are impossible to get today. Those are OEM parts made of fiberglass that are paper thin and would wear off. If you stood on the pegs, they would be worn out.
Or melted by the pipe or something, right?
Yeah, yeah. And
even the cork washer holding, did you mention how rare this piece is here? Those are like super unobtainium. Those are really usually removed. And it gives it a nice torquey power band down low, and it revs out nicely. So what is the GS tune? What is it? Is that a factory?
Yeah, it's a factory endorsed tuning. GS, I'm not sure where they existed in the Penton hierarchy, but they were highly regarded as the best performing KTM engines. And prior to that, Sax engines for the Penton motorcycle.
So like a factory port timing setup and everything to get the optimum performance
exactly
on it.
Exactly right. Whether it was for off-road or if it was for motocross, I believe they had two different tunes. So this bike is just mint. No excuses. Everything about it, in my opinion, is correct.
The special washers on the Penton license plate, the signature by John Penton, the fenders look brand new.
This is a special bike.
Junior, you want to add anything about this beautiful piece?
There's something about the European bikes, man, and I mean, we can keep harping on it, but this is the profile of a dual tip muffler, and then this number plate, the odometer, and then the lighting kit, all just a factory package, and for it to be in this condition, this is a really obscure motorcycle that would be difficult to replace.
This is the one as kids that we lusted after but couldn't afford. You know, this is the one that got away. If we were lucky, we had a Hodaka 100 or a Suzuki TM100 like I had, and, you know, everybody wanted the Penton, whether it was the 100cc, was it Pine?
Berkshire,
and then there was a Pine something, right? It was a 125.
The 125 was a 6-day, and then the Jack Pine was a
Jack
175.
Piner. Yeah, the 175, yep. The colors, the yellow with green, the red ones, they're just beautiful bikes. And this, to me, would have been the flagship model, the 250, the ultimate off-road ISDT weapon. So,
and I believe this period is when Penton and KTM conspired to make up the game. They had top components, and they had innovations that nobody else had at the time. You know, including their components were second to none, and their build quality was mint. You know, the Austrians built it, Penton badged it here in America and put his own things on it, you know, including possibly the tool bag and some other accessories. But, you know, this was a KTM in Europe, and it was badged as a Penton in America. And this was getting near the end of the era for Penton KTM, and eventually it became just KTM.
Thank you, Professor. That's why we nicknamed him the Professor. So, seriously, guys, kick-ass piece, Michelin tires. The consumables have been upgraded, including the Michelin tires, the nice modern gold heavy-duty chain, and, of course, those Works Performance shocks. Those are $500 set of high-performance dual-spring shocks that'll save your back if you actually do race it. So I'm going to go ride it one more time. She's going on display in the off-road section on the third floor of the New England Motorcycle Museum. If you'd like to come take a look at it, I'd say hurry up because I'm pretty sure this is going to sell as soon as we put it up. Good luck finding a nicer one, and thanks for watching.
God bless America.
Good luck bidding, boys. Message your zip code for a shipping quote. Call us with any questions, 860-454-7024. Ripa.